Welcome, Bach.
Now, my wife told me not to tell that joke. Now I'm feeling rebellious, I guess.
Welcome to lecture two of this four-part series on the life and times of Johann Sebastian Bach. In our first lecture, we talked about the legacy of Bach, how he's perceived today. And we talked about how nowadays, if you were to visit most college campuses and conservatories, when they teach music theory, when they teach the rules, how music works, and what you should and shouldn't do as a composer in order to facilitate the performance of your music, what we sometimes call good voice leading, how to make your music singable, how to make the harmony fit together in an elegant way, we study Bach. So nowadays, 300 years later, more or less, Bach is considered to represent the apogee of not only the Baroque style, but also, to some degree, of music in general. But we talked also about how Bach, in his own day, was underappreciated, misunderstood to some degree, and on some level, as we saw in the case of his application for the position of the Thomaskirche Kapellmeister, the sort of the chapel music master at St. Thomas Church in Leipzig, we saw that people back then, some of them, really didn't get it at all. If you remember, he was number five on the list of applicants, and it wasn't until people took other positions, the people who had been offered the job first, that Bach was, they had to settle for him, to use the language of that infamous quote. Well, we also talked about some of Bach's music. We talked about his organ works. We talked about the intricacies involved in executing the technical playing of an organ piece. That is to say, playing Bach's organ music requires very coordinated synchronization between not only the two hands, but also the feet as well, which have to play the lower voice of the fugue, lowest voice, I should say. And remember, we talked about the nature of imitative polyphony. If Bach introduces a melody in the right hand, well, the left hand is going to have to play that same exact melody at some point. And if the left hand is going to play it, well, you know where it's going. As we saw last week, the feet have to play that same melody. No matter how virtuosic, you'll have to play it in the feet as well. So we talked about the organ being this instrument which separates the proverbial wheat from the chaff amongst musicians. That is to say, to use the line I used last week, there are very few, and I still yet to meet one, there are very few amateur organists. To play the organ casually, the way that some might play guitar, for example, well, that would be very unlikely to have coordinated mastery of the hands and feet. And to do that on a casual level, that would be very unusual. To be exposed and have access to an organ at all, we said, would be unusual. After we discussed organ music, and in doing so learned a lot about the aesthetic style of the Baroque period, we then turned our attention to a substantial body of works that we call cantatas. Of course, knowing what a cantata is, that's easy because the word itself just radiates singing. And that's what they are. They're works that are meant to be sung. Should be noted, by the way, that Bach did not use the term cantata. He simply called these pieces, for the most part, Kirchenstück, which simply means a church piece. And we had kind of an infinitesimal amount of time to talk about cantatas. At least it felt that way. When you've got 200 cantatas that are extant, and they're on average 25 to 30 minutes each, well, 15 or 20 minutes feels like a woefully inadequate amount of time. So I've blocked a little bit of time at the beginning of tonight's program to revisit cantatas and to say a few more things before we take on the main course, which of course is instrumental music with a special focus on the six enigmatic virtuosic works known as the Brandenburg Concertos, or if you want to impress your friends, you can use the Italian plural and call them the Brandenburg Concerti. Before we do that, I want to say a few words more about cantatas. These works were not written for an audience the way we think of that word today. Really, the whole idea of a paying concert-going audience that's going to take their disposable income and buy a ticket to go see a show, that's something that starts really in the decades after Bach's death. In Paris, for example, with the Concert Spirituel, and later on in Vienna, where they're starting to sell subscriptions, so you buy sort of You buy a package deal to see a whole series of concerts or a season's worth of concerts. So that's a modern phenomenon, but it's anachronistic to talk about it in Bach's day. He didn't have an audience, really. Most of the time, the people that heard this music were congregants. They were people who went to church, who were in the pews, so to speak, on Sundays. And the music was part of a package deal that also included a sermon and a meditation, typically on the gospel readings of that particular Sunday on the liturgical calendar. Now, why do I bring this up? Because it's important to understand why Bach's writing music and why this music sounds the way it does. He's not writing it so that people will feel sort of that warm, fuzzy sensation we get when we listen to an especially powerful Brahms symphony, say the slow movement from Symphony No. 3, or the feeling we get when we listen to Beethoven 9 or Mahler 2. Those are works that are much further down the road, and their purpose, their existence, has a totally different genesis. But Bach's writing music to send a message on it. And what kind of messages is he sending? Are these happy, uplifting messages? Well, for the most part, the answer is not really. Many of them are rather sobering. As we said last week, Bach was a man who grew up in this pietist Lutheran tradition. And those Protestant denominations that emerged out of the religious conflicts of the 16th century, the pietist Lutherans, the Zwinglians, those followers of Ulrich Zwingli in Switzerland, the followers of John Calvin, Calvinists, who we're going to talk about later on today. When Bach wrote the Brandenburg Concerti, he was actually in a Calvinist court of Anhalt-Köthen, not too far from where he grew up, but still it changed his trajectory as a composer. So those adherents to this very doctrinally strict version of Protestantism were intent on using music to project, to broadcast this message. What message is that? Well, much of it has to do with sin, with human malfeasance, the low, corrupted, depraved nature of mankind. Durch Adams Fall ist ganz verderbt. Through the fall of Adam, everything has become corrupted. Here's a cantata where we have a soprano aria. And the soprano sings the words, Meine Sünden kränken mich. Translation, my sins make me sick. As the soprano, by the way, this is not Renee Fleming singing this. This is not even a castrato singer that you would find perhaps further down south in Italy. This is a 10-year-old boy in all likelihood. And this boy, he's got to really power through these lines because they're not easy. Vocally, that is to say, they're very tricky to sing. And if we were to analyze this score, we would see that even further. Meine Sünden kränken mich. He repeats it. Kränken mich. Next. Als ein Eiter in Gebeinen. Eiter is an interesting word in German. It can mean pus or infection. So my sins make me sick like a pus in Gebeinen, in my bones. Which is then, and notice, by the way, if you can see these symbols, means that the music is sort of straying away from where it's supposed to be. We call this kind of music chromatic music. And what that means is that it's going to be tricky for the singer, and it's also going to disorient the listener to some degree. It's going to shift their sense of stability, make you feel like you're on musical quicksand, if you will. Als ein Eiter in Gebeinen, so that is repeated, and it's repeated again, rising into the higher register, and then finally going down. Next, hilf mir, help me, Jesu, Gottes Lamm. Well, that needs no translation. Help me, Jesus, Lamb of God. Hilf mir, Jesu, Gottes Lamm. Notice rising up. Ich versink in tiefen Schlamm. Notice the line actually sinks on the word versink, in tiefen Schlamm. Repeat it again, and then repeat it one more time. Hilf mir, Jesu Gottes Lamm, ich versink in tiefen Schlamm. Help me, Jesus, Lamb of God, I am sinking into deep muck, slime. And tonally, this is very ambiguous territory. And I know that the music theory is a little bit nebulous to some, but for what it's worth, this is an aria in A minor, and here we have cadence to C minor. So Bach is clearly trying to make the music, he's imbuing it with a certain quality that I think
is deliberately intended to make the listener feel a sense of unease. And certainly, no matter how good that 10-year-old boy is, no matter how good, there's just no way to get the breath support in those 10-year-old lungs to sing this phrase, to project equally at the top of the fifth octave and then down below middle C. There's just no way to do it. In other words, I think Bach probably wanted this music to sound absolutely tortured. And so to do that, he subjects this poor boy soprano to what he knows will be really impossible to pull off. And that, to musicians today, is anathema to the way we think as musicians. Because we want the music to sound polished, right? We want to present the best product. We don't want the music to sound bad on purpose. Maybe if some postmodern thing, but that would be very unusual. And most modern performers would have a lot of trouble relating to that. But Bach does it, and he does it more than once. There's a cantata where he writes a solo, it's for a trombone terrarsi, a sort of baroque slide trumpet. It almost looks like a miniature trombone. And the alto soloist, who's singing along, is singing about how we should try to model our lives upon the life of Jesus. But in the B section, she says, it's impossible to do that because humans are depraved, low, corrupt, base creatures, given to sin, worthless and rotting, and we have really no hope except to hope for God's salvation. Remember, Lutheranism teaches that salvation is a gift given by God. Sometimes called justification by faith alone. In other words, good deeds are great, but they've got really nothing to do with it. God is going to choose you or he won't. So in this aria, that's basically what the alto is saying. You can try to live a virtuous life, but you can't, because you're a worthless, rotting, corrupt, awful human being. Doesn't matter how good you try to be. That's just your nature. That happened in the fall of Adam. That's why. And while this is going on, the trumpet, the terrarsi, is asked to play in a key that instrument can't play it. It just can't. It's not possible. It has to play these notes, G sharps and B. It just can't play those notes. So what's the product? The product is that the trumpet player, inevitably, no matter how good, no matter how big a virtuoso, is going to make mistakes, or they're going to sound out of tune. I shouldn't say they're making mistakes. They're going to sound out of tune. They'll sound like they're making mistakes. Bach does that on purpose. Remember, what's the point of the music? To tell you that no matter how much you try to be a good person, to live a virtuous lifestyle, you're going to sin. You're going to drink too much. You're going to gamble. You're going to go to a brothel. You're going to yell at your wife or your family. You're going to lose your temper. You're going to cheat someone in business. You can't help it. And to show the fallibility of human nature, Bach has this poor trumpet player playing out of tune on purpose. And it's wonderful. You hear it, and it's just hard to describe that sound. Nowadays, there is this whole period authenticity movement, and they don't know what to do with this. Actually, now they've got it worked out. But in the 90s, when it started, when they said, all right, we're not going to play it on a modern vowel trumpet, we're going to do it on the original instrument. That's period authenticity, right? Let's do it the way that Bach did it. And in the 90s and early 2000 aughts, they didn't know what the heck to do with this. They're in the studio, can you imagine? Are we supposed to? And finally, after consulting extensively with the scholarship, with the musicologists who researched this, they figured, you know what? It's supposed to sound sort of tortured. So let's embrace that. All right, I want to share a short audio clip before we move on to the Brandenburg Concerti. This one is from Cantata 12, which has this charming title, Weinen, Klagen, Sorgen, Zagen, Weeping, Lamenting, Worrying, Despairing. And Bach does this great thing to start. He creates this series of very important musical phenomena. I'm going to play it on the piano in a minute. He creates a series of what we call suspensions. Now, without getting too much into the theory, let me explain what that means. It means that the music is going to constantly shift between moments of instability, moments of jarring dissonance, and then moments of resolution. And it's this constant ebb and flow between the two. That's what drives the music forward, and that's what creates so much interest, I think, for the listener, and also, of course, for the player who has to often come up with interesting hand configurations, if you're playing keyboard, for example, to work these dissonances in and to play them on purpose. Singers have a lot of trouble with this, because when you ask somebody to sing notes that sound like they clash on purpose, create what we sometimes call crunch in music, well, it's a very unintuitive thing to do. Let me play on the piano. This is from a collection known as the Well-Tempered Clavier, which I'll discuss later on in the program. We start with two voices in the right hand, and they sound like this. Hear that? Next. Do you hear that ebb and flow? Constantly pinging back and forth between consonants and dissonance, between stability and instability. Add in a walking bass line and you get something like this. Moments of repose and moments of jarring, clashing between the tones. Things like this. On purpose. And this is, of course, what creates, I think, an interesting musical piece. One of the changes out of the early Renaissance, and certainly by the time we get to the Baroque period, is the embrace of dissonance as a propellant of sorts, something that drives the music forward, that can undermine a cadence and make things sound less final so that you can continue developing an idea. Well, when it comes to a text like weeping, lamenting, despairing, and worrying, Bach is obviously going to use special music. So let's just listen to the first couple of minutes of this opening movement, and if we can get the track lights at least. There. Angst und Not sind den Christen's Tränenbrot. Anguish and despair are the Christian's bread of tears. Not a traditional marketing strategy for selling Bach's music. But he's not selling his music. Remember, Bach's writing music for most of his career in these provincial towns in Saxony. It's now more or less eastern central Germany. And he's not, I think Bach would be very tickled to think that people on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, we're talking about his music 300 years after he wrote it. So, all right, let's move on to something a bit more uplifting. And we're going to talk now about the Brandenburg Concerti. So, first let me discuss how Bach finds himself in a position where he wants to write this kind of music. Bach had been working in the city of Weimar for about 6 years. But his children were growing up. And more importantly, one of his employers, who had been a very magnanimous employer, died. One of the Dukes of Weimar, Ernst Ludwig. And Bach is now facing certain budget cuts, you might say. He's not going to get that same level of support from his employer. The new Duke, who was ruling Weimar, was not as enthusiastic about music, and perhaps to some degree didn't recognize Bach's genius, I think it's fair to use that word, even by 1717. That's what we see in the music. So Bach's looking for a new job, but you can't just put in your 2 weeks' notice in 1717. You've got a job and you've got to fulfill your responsibilities. And so Bach, of course, approaches the new duke, and he says, hey, listen, I'd really like to pursue a job elsewhere, and you know, better salary, perhaps better schools for my children. And his boss says, no. So if you can't quit, you do the next best thing, which is get yourself fired. And that's exactly what Bach did. And it leads to the genesis of an interesting work. After refusing to fulfill his responsibilities as Concertmeister, which needs no translation, concertmaster, of the court capella in Weimar, Bach was put under a sort of detention. And in detention, he's forced to meditate on his stubbornness and so on. And so he asks for only a few things. You know, he has his Bible there, of course, Luther Bible, naturally, perhaps translated sermons he can read, Johann Jakob Rambach and the like. And he's got some manuscript paper to write some music. No, he doesn't have a keyboard in the room. He doesn't have any musical instruments. And legend has it that it's there, with no musical instruments handy, that he starts the well-tempered clavier, which he would eventually finish in 1722. How do you write music with no keyboard? Well, think of Beethoven. Remember last year, for those who were able to make it to that lecture series, we talked about how musicians hear with the inner ear, and that if you were a really good musician, you can sort of look at the score and know what it sounds like without having to play it or have someone play it or sing it. And I've witnessed people doing this, and it's kind of breathtaking and a little obnoxious, to be honest, in a wonderful way. I think I've told this story before, but I had a professor who was, oh, probably 75, 80 years old, and he had smoked cigarettes for a long time, so he had this very distinctive voice. And I handed him, it was an independent study, and I handed him 50 pages of manuscript, a string quartet I was composing. And he's flipping through, and he gets to the end of the first movement, and he says something like, you know, measure 12 should have been a G-sharp in the viola, measure 113 should have been a B-flat in the cello. And he just, he heard it. You know, that's something that, if you just look at it, it can escape your notice. But if you have that inner ear, it's a very abstract, and I think it's fair to say it's not a very well-understood concept, because people who have it have a hard time explaining it. That's their nature, right? It explains something that just comes naturally to you. So that's where he starts the well-tempered clavier. He then moves to the court of Anhalt-Köthen, where he takes up residence and employment under a very enthusiastic music lover, Leopold II, the prince of Anhalt-Köthen, who was a very avid and enthusiastic flautist, and who recognized Bach's worth and paid him a very substantial salary in order to lure him to Köthen. He knew he would have to lure him there because Köthen, as I alluded to earlier, was not a Lutheran territory. It was a Calvinist territory. Now, since the 16th century, the Peace of Augsburg, there was this idea that the subjects in a given territory would adhere to the religious denomination of that particular prince. So Bach here is, it's you've got to sell it to him, right, to bring him to a territory where he's going to be, to some extent, uncomfortable on a doctrinal level. It should be said, however, that really Calvinism and Lutheranism are very similar in many regards. For example, both adhere to the principle of consubstantiation rather than transubstantiation. Catholics, of course, Catholic doctrine teaches that when the priest blesses and consecrates the bread, he says, hoc est corpus meum, this is my body, and that bread is no longer bread. It's now the body of Christ. Of course, the Lutherans and Calvinists believe in consubstantiation. Con meaning we. In other words, the host contains what theologians call the real presence. However, the bread is not transformed. There's no miracle of the Mass, as they say. So they're similar on that level. But one big difference, I would say, between Calvin and Luther, there are a few, but if I had to pick one, I'll pick one that I think makes Calvinism very distinct, very easy to remember. Calvin believed that there was this foreordained nature to the universe, and that the destiny of human beings has been decided before you were even born. That is to say, whether you're going to go to heaven and attain salvation, or whether you're going to be damned and go to hell, that's decided before you're born. Now that creates some interesting philosophical arguments. And here's how it traditionally explained by Calvinist theologians, is that You don't know who's going to go to heaven or hell. You have no idea. God's already chosen them, but you don't know who they are. However, well, if you meet someone who commits all sorts of malfeasance, who lies and cheats and steals, well, that person's probably going to hell. So God chose that person to sin so that they would eventually wind up in hell. But if someone's, you know, doing good deeds and helping people and volunteering and is honest, well, that person's going to go to heaven. No, God chose that person to go to heaven. Well, what's the natural way that people are going to react to that? They're going to want to commit good deeds so that they can think, hey, God chose me. I volunteered at that soup kitchen last week. That must mean that God chose me. See the idea? So it's an interesting doctrinal difference here. Luther talks about justification by faith and salvation, but he doesn't really talk about people going to hell. Let's talk about the other side of that argument, whereas Calvin goes into it quite a bit. And that particular point was argued in a book by Calvin from the 1530s called The Institutions of the Christian Religion, for those who are interested. All right. So the Brandenburg Concerti. Bach is now in a Calvinist territory, so he's not going to be writing liturgical music. He's not going to be writing these cantatas that are meant to resonate with the Lutheran faith. Instead, he turns his attention to instrumental music, and this is a very fertile period of instrumental music writing. We're going to talk about two concerti, but before we do, that's something very funny, funny by our standards, a little bit nauseating to be honest, but you'll see what I'm talking about in a moment when we read the dedication letter of the Brandenburg Concerti. We call it Brandenburg because it was dedicated to a guy named Christian Ludwig, who held the lofty noble title of the Margrave of Brandenburg. He was a relation of Frederick the Great, and he was somebody who had means to really help a guy like Bach out. Bach hoped for a big commission or an honorarium of sorts, we might say, to use today's parlance. He never got one, by the way. These works, though they're recognized today as some of the greatest instrumental pieces of the period, sat on a shelf for 130 years before anyone dusted them off. And that was around 1850, if you can believe it. So Bach writes these concerti, and he puts a beautiful package together, and he sends them to the Margrave of Brandenburg with a handwritten letter. Of course, it's handwritten, and it's a dedication. They didn't have the Gutenberg printing press at this point. And here's how the letter reads, courtesy of Wikipedia. As I had the good fortune a few years ago to be heard by your Royal Highness at your Highness's commands, and as I noticed then that your Highness took some pleasure in the little talents which heaven has given me for music, and as in taking leave of your Royal Highness, your Highness, how many Highnesses do we have in this sense? Your Highness deigned to honor me with the command to send your Highness some pieces of my composition, colon. I have in accordance with your Highness's most gracious orders taken the liberty of rendering my most humble duty to your Royal Highness with the present concertos, which I have adapted to several instruments, begging your Highness most humbly not to judge their imperfection with the rigor of that discriminating and sensitive taste which everyone knows him to have for musical works, but rather to take into benign consideration the profound respect and the most humble obedience which I thus attempt to show him. I wish I'd get my students to write me emails like this. Your royal professorship. As your royal professorship knows, I did not turn in the term paper. I humbly beg your royal professorship. All right. There's a lot to say about this, but we'll go over it very quickly so we can focus on listening. Remember, I told you it would be funny and slightly nauseating. Why is it nauseating? Let's start there. Well, because Bach is clearly writing things which he knows are untrue. The Margrave knows are untrue, but they have to maintain that patina, that facade of propriety between their vastly disparate social classes. So Bach has to use the phrase of another generation, has to suck up. This is about as obsequious as it gets, isn't it? Using your Royal Highness in every clause and then some. And then there's that line at the end, I beg your Highness not to judge their imperfection, suggesting that this guy, Christian Ludwig, the Margrave of Brandenburg,
somehow in a position where he can judge Bach's work and tell you what's wrong with Bach's music. Again, it has this phoniness that it smacks of, does it not? And yet, this was the floral language of the time, and this was what was expected of a composer. Composers are servants in the Baroque period, and if you want that gelt, the money, which you're hoping to get, that's really what this is about. Favor is part of it too, and perhaps a better job down the road sometime, but it's really about trying to earn that honorarium. You've got to really make that prince feel like he's the most important person in the world, and Bach does that here. One other thing about these that I think is very interesting. He calls these pieces concertos which he's adapted for several instruments, and that's really the essence of the Brandenburg Concerti. If I were to ask you, what did you learn tonight about the Brandenburg Concerti? If someone asked you that, you would say that they're extremely unusual concerti because they're written for unusual combinations of instruments. And we're going to look at two examples, and I think you'll appreciate how different these pieces sound. What do I mean by that? Let's talk about it for a couple of minutes. In the Baroque period, the concerto was born. It's an invention of the Baroque period. But it's not the same concerto that you imagine, perhaps, when you hear that word. Because for many people, when they hear the word concerto, how many people think of Mozart or Beethoven or perhaps Rachmaninoff, Tchaikovsky, Brahms, Saint-Saëns, Schumann? I mean, many names come to mind. And often when we think of a concerto, we think of what was later developed and became overwhelmingly popular, and that is the solo concerto. Concerto written for one instrument, Mendelssohn violin concerto in E minor. That one violin is to stand right next to the conductor, but really to be the focal point of everything that's happening on stage. Tchaikovsky, the B-flat minor piano concerto. It's about the pianist, really. Tchaikovsky, D major violin concerto. It's about the violin. In the Baroque period, there were solo concertos, but there was you're more likely to find something called the concerto grosso, which was something that was a genre, I should say, that was honed by composers like Arcangelo Corelli, Antonio Vivaldi, Georg Friedrich Handel, and even Bach. These really are an example, to some degree, of the concerto grosso, but with a few important wrinkles. So what you're more likely to encounter in the Baroque period is a group of soloists. Here's the wrinkle. The typical concerto grosso has a concertino group, so a group of soloists, but they're string players, usually emphasizing violin. Two violins and a viola, and then a cello and a basso continuo group. That's your soloist group. Here's what Bach does, and he alludes to it in this letter. He says he's adapted these concerti for multiple instruments. And what that means is, each of the six concerti, there are six in the set, are going to feature a different group of soloists. And these groups of soloists, the combinations of instruments, are so imaginative, so wacky, in a way, that they are completely unprecedented. Nobody had ever done anything like it or even remotely similar to it. Bach is doing something here which has absolutely no precedent in music history. What do I mean by that? We're going to kind of go a little bit out of order. I want to start with Brandenburg 4 because it's such a great example of how Bach takes an atypical instrument in the modern era, but in the Baroque era, he's able to deploy it to considerable effect. And this is an instrument known as, and you've all probably played one or heard one played at some point, the recorder. Mm-hmm. Or in German, Blockflöte. Think block, think like it's carved out of a block of wood. How many people have played a recorder? How many people have heard a recorder play? Maybe you went to a concert, your kids, your grandkids, and they played Hot Cross Buns. Yeah. And it's sort of, you know, the second graders, they practiced hard and they sound like, you know. Well, the recorder has gotten a bad rap, has it not? It's a very stigmatized instrument because we tend to associate it with cheap plastic PVC imported from China, a few bucks to buy one, $3 or $4, and you got a soprano recorder. They don't have particularly nice timbres, that is to say the sound color is not particularly pleasing. And of course, most importantly,
we give these instruments to incompetent, God bless their hearts, they try, but mostly incompetent children who are 6 years old, 8 years old or something, and therefore destined to sound like neophytes playing really cheap instruments. But in Bach's day, the recorder was a virtuoso instrument. It was really, until the late Baroque period, it was used more often than the flute that we think of, which Bach did use occasionally, but he would have called that flute the flauto traverso. Traverso comes from the Italian meaning transverse, and that tells you that it's held perpendicular to the body, supposed to be recorded, which is of course held here. So Bach's going to write a concerto, Brandenburg 4, and he's going to feature two recorder players, one higher pitched than the other, and a violin soloist. So three instruments in the group, two recorders of different sizes, and a violin. Of course, the recorder back then is made of wood, it's carved, and it's fashioned by an expert, an artisan often. These were people who you had to do your apprenticeship, and you had to work for 6 years before you could join a trade guild who made recorders, and before you were licensed to make and sell these. So this was something that, you know, a lot of work went into making these recorders. And they have beautiful timbre, beautiful sound color, very different from that shrill plastic quality that you get from the recorders that the second graders. Now, I played one when I was in the, you know, PS-178 in Queens. Fourth grade, I think they gave us recorders. Boy, they trotted us out there to play Mary Lamb or whatever it was. Then Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. They're wonderful instruments, but they've gotten a very bad rap. So hopefully we'll start to erase and expunge that stigma as we listen to Brandenburg 4. So this one is written in a gently lilting triple meter, 3/8 time, and it has this yap bop 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 bop. So we'll really feel it in 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Now there's something very fun to listen for, which is going to come up a few times, a number of times. And this is a musical effect, which everyone here will be able to hear, has a very peculiar name. It's called a hemiola. Sounds like a blood disorder. But a hemiola is in fact a rhythmic phenomenon, whereby the composer will, remember we talked about dissonance before? This is like a rhythmic dissonance. It's going to make the music feel like it's shifted in its accents rhythmically. Remember, rhythm is just all about repeating patterns of strong notes, strong beats and weak beats. We count 1, 2, 1, 2. Why do we count it like that? Because the arrival, the strong beat happens on the 1. So 1 feels strong, that's when the pattern repeats. So Bach's going to do this funny thing where you're going to have 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1. And he does that to intensify the cadence, to make the cadence sound really satisfying. Remember, a cadence is a moment of arrival. So to drive into the cadence, he's going to have the rhythm completely disrupted. And as listeners, once again, as we saw with the melodic and harmonic dissonance earlier, this is a sort of rhythmic dissonance, but it creates a very satisfying effect when it resolves. All right, so we'll listen to the first movement of Brandenburg 1. Here's a great color score. You'll notice the teal, whatever this aqua color, and the green are the recorders, the yellow is the violin. The violin gets a significant workout in this movement. There's a part where the violin is asked to play a stream of 32nd notes, and it's all notated, it's not improvised, it's played exactly note for note. And if you're counting 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and you've got to go, it's almost impossible to play it on any instrument besides perhaps a violin and maybe a few others. This would not be something that could be transcribed for another instrument. It's very, we say, idiomatically written for the violin, which of course was an instrument that Bach understood very well. So here's first movement of Brandenburg 4. That's the Bach Collegium Japan under the direction of Masaki Suzuki. Now, it may surprise you to learn this, but one of the curious developments in the recording industry and in the performance sphere of Bach study and Bach performance is that in the 90s, really, there emerged this phenomenon of profound Bach appreciation of all places in Japan. And this was spearheaded by a guy named Masaki Suzuki, who directs the Collegium Japan. And if you're looking for recordings, that can often be a point of, for some listeners, it can be a point of confusion or uncertainty. You're not sure what performers to or what group to listen to. when it comes to Bach, you can't go wrong with the play in Japan. It's a thoroughly researched, period, authentic performance, and done with great rigor and by some of the best musicians in the world, especially when it comes to playing on these instruments, which are not instruments that most people take up in high school or even college. To play a baroque violin, well, you've already got to start with a regular violin. Nobody's going to start on a baroque violin. The same is true of playing a true, authentic baroque recorder or any of the instruments we're going to talk about in the next concerto. Were you able to hear the rhythmic instability in that cadential hymniola? 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. It's great. It creates this intensity, which is very much sort of the rhythmic analog of the dissonance we talked about earlier, as I said. All right. Here's something that some of you may be familiar with this piece because that's not Bach. Many people here might have heard at some point the audio recordings of any of the great courses, right, where they have college-style lectures, which are recorded by established, venerable pedagogues in their respective disciplines. And in fact, now, they didn't have this when I was a kid, I don't think, or at least I was unaware of them. I grew up in the era of analog cassettes. So now with libraries, it's great. You can use your library membership. You have access to a lot of these great courses. And the reason I bring this up is because many of the great courses, and I've listened to some on theology, everything from 16th century theology to theoretical astrophysics to the history of the 30 Years' War. I mean, I've listened to a lot of these great courses, and many of them begin with the introduction to the lecture by playing the opening clip from Brandenburg 2. And it's worth taking 30 seconds to talk about why. I think the answer is because if you're marketing something called the Great Courses, and you want your audience to be mentally prepared for a mentally nourishing and enriching, sophisticated experience, well, what do? You play music that reflects or represents that polished, sophisticated quality. And so in this case, whoever it was, the producer, I guess, who made those recordings, decided to pipe in Bach's Brandenburg Concerto number 2. I think part of the reason they chose number 2 is because it features a brass instrument. And brass has that bold, brilliant quality that can be very captivating. Someone was, in fact, telling me before the lecture tonight about how they had heard arrangements of Bach's fugue, polyphonic music, fugues and toccatas and preludes and so on, arranged for brass instruments. The brass family has a very particular timbre which captivates us as listeners, I think, and that's going to be especially true here because this is not the garden variety B-flat concert trumpet. This is a baroque trumpet, but not just any baroque trumpet. It's a baroque, what they call a clarino trumpet, meaning it plays in the higher register. It's pitched even higher than the natural trumpet, which was a baroque version of modern trumpet, and it has no vowels. No vowels. You'll see him manipulating very small holes, but for the most part, he's controlling the notes of the harmonic series through his armature, through his lip muscle, the tightening of the lip and mouth muscles, and the air control from the diaphragm. That's how you have to play this instrument. Let me put it this way. There's a reason why this instrument is basically obsolete. The only reason in 2019 you'd ever play it is if you're dedicated to learning the art of Baroque music and to attempting to capture that period authenticity which we keep revisiting tonight because it is so intertwined with the modern recording era. The only other reason I can think of that you play this instrument is if you're a masochist who likes to beat yourself up for being out of tune and missing notes. All right. This is not just a period authentic performance, but it's a period authentic venue. This was recorded in the famous Spiegelsaal in Schlosskirchen. Schloss in German, of course, means castle. So this was recorded in Castle Köthen, or Köthen Castle. And the Spiegelsaal literally means the Hall of Mirrors. And this is kind of, you'll see it in the video when we get the lights down and you're able to see the nature of this venue. Remember last week we talked about Palace of Versailles. We talked about the embellishment, the ornamentation, which is very much a part of Baroque art. In fact, the word Baroque comes from a Portuguese word, baroco, meaning referring to a certain type of especially irregular and resplendent pearl. So the word itself, Baroque, suggests something that captivates, something that shines. And you'll see that in the architecture and in the hall that they're playing in, which is this preserved hall, which probably did not look dissimilar 300 years ago when Bach was living in Köthen. Actually, we're coming up on the 300th anniversary of the Brandenburg Concerti. Their premiere, because as I said earlier, they were not appreciated and performed. We'll talk about that at the end of the program. These pieces were put on the shelves of history, and we're going to talk about why they collected dust after we listen. But first we'll listen because it will illuminate part of the answer to that question. So we have four instruments that are serving in the concertino ensemble, micro ensemble here, the ensemble within the ensemble. And you'll see them arrayed out in front. Remember I said that the Brandenburg Concerti are noteworthy for many reasons, one of which is that Bach is using completely unprecedented combinations of instruments. Remember he wrote in his dedication, let's go back to it, concertos adapted to several instruments. And this had never been done before, using this combination. Bach, you know, part of this language, Your Highness, these meager compositions, adapted for some, he describes it in such humble terms, to some degree because that was the convention of the time, but to another degree because Bach, being a pietist Lutheran, believed in what it says in the good book. They say the meek shall inherit. Right? So this is Bach's, it wasn't that he saw himself as some grand composer who needed to command a huge salary. I think in all likelihood, Bach thought of himself as fulfilling a purpose at church for most of his career, and that these works would be performed in his own lifetime. But once he died, that was it. We've been very tickled to think that people studied this music hundreds of years later. All right. So what are the instruments in our concertino group? Well, we've got a violin, because that's the workhorse of the Baroque period, and really most periods of music history. But we also got an oboe, which was an instrument that Bach favored quite a bit. In addition to that, we have another recorder. This one is what nowadays we would call an alto recorder pitched in F. And finally, the bold, brilliant sound of the clavino trumpet played, and that's a valveless Baroque trumpet played here by a guy. He's the only one sitting down. And the harpsichord assists too, but it seems like the kind of instrument that you want to conserve as much energy as you can. So you'll see him reaching for notes which are in the absolute stratosphere of brass instruments. That is to say, they're so high-pitched that to this day, even on a modern, adapted for modern analog trumpet, this is still considered a very virtuosic part and very difficult to hit those tippity-top high notes, which will be so high that some ears, they may sound almost piercing. I say almost, but not quite. I like to use the word bold or brilliant to describe the sound of the Baroque trumpet. You'll decide for yourself, we'll listen to the first movement, and as I said, some of you may recognize it because this is the introduction to countless lectures in the Great Courses series. Here is Bach's Brandenburg Concerto No. 2 in the key of F. To refer back to a question that I posed to you before this brief listening odyssey of ours through Brandenburg 2, movement 1, I asked, why did this music collect dust for 130 years before it was ever performed properly? And the answer, I think, can be gleaned to some degree from our listening experience here, which is to say that listening to this music informs us of how difficult it is to pull it off. And we see that especially in the trumpet part, the clarino trumpet part, but really in all the parts. This is not easy music to play. We watch these virtuoso musicians who have been practicing who knows how many hours, and they can pull it off, but to do this kind of music, any Bach really, whether it's solo keyboard repertoire or cantatas, or certainly the orchestral stuff, it's exceptionally difficult. And to do it, furthermore, on period authentic instruments nowadays, that's why you have to find these specialists who have taken the time to hone their skills on that particular instrument. So what happened, we think, is that this music was presented to the Margrave of Brandenburg. Remember him? Brandenburg, by the way, for those of you who are thinking about Berlin and the Brandenburg Gate, well, of course, that was the region, so northern Germany, what it corresponds to nowadays. There is no northern Germany in 1720. This would have been Prussian territory. Remember, Frederick the Great and his father, Frederick William, they were kings of Prussia, not of Germany. No Germany until 1871. So, we don't know exactly what transpired, but we imagine it went something like this. We, meaning historians, musicologists, we think that music was presented to Margrave. And probably he didn't know what to make of it because he wasn't a good enough musician. So he probably handed it to his Kapellmeister, his sort of chief of court music making, and said, what do you think of this? And the guy probably looked at it. Brandenburg I has two horn soloists, and the horn is an incredibly difficult instrument to play. Now, you can imagine what it was like before valves. Two natural horns, and a scordatura tuned piccolo violin. Number two we listen to, number four we listen to with the recorders, number five has an incredibly difficult harpsichord solo with a transverse flute and a violin. Number six has no violins, it's all violas. We think that this guy looked at the score and probably told Brandenburg, we can't do it. This can't be performed by our Kapelle here, by our orchestra. Bach knew it could be performed because when he was living in Köthen, remember with Prince Leopold, his new employer, he knew a guy there who was an expert clarino trumpet virtuoso. Gottfried Reinhard Zilbermann or something like that. Bach knew that it could be done. He wasn't a brass player himself, but he knew that it could, in theory, be performed. But if you travel a couple of hundred miles north, they might not have anybody in a radius of however many miles who can do it. And therefore, the piece becomes unperformable. So Bach was very ambitious here, but ultimately, perhaps a little too ambitious for the ears of that period and for the performers of that period. Around 1850, that's 130 years, give or take, after these pieces were written, they were rediscovered, and now, of course, they're performed by various ensembles all over the place. Sometimes by fanatical period authentic groups who want to do it on baroque violins with harpsichord and the instruments that we see here, the baroque oboe and recorder, and some people will do with a modern recorder and say something that's not, it's fabricated, still made out of wood, but made in the modern era, or regular standard violins, or a standard oboe, etc. So people do it all sorts of ways, but these pieces have made their way into the standard canon and they are performed all the time. However, that was not always the case. And as we'll see when we get to next week's program, that was the case with so much of Bach's music. So much of it was written and lost for decades, more than a century for many of these pieces. Some of them, in rare cases, the well-tempered clavier was studied, the B minor mass was known to many musicians, the Goldberg variations were known to many musicians, but for the most part, these pieces were lost to history for a long time. It wasn't until really the 20th century, I think, that the proper sort of renaissance of Bach appreciation began. Now, it's interesting to think, by the way, that off on one of the Voyager probes that got the when they wanted to send out the art that would represent human civilization, if this probe is ever intercepted by an alien civilization, what music would they find? Well, some of the music that was chosen, I think Carl Sagan was the advisor, and he consulted with some musicians on that. And so Bach was chosen, I think it was the Goldberg variations that was chosen. We'll get to the Goldberg variations in week four. Let me tell you what's on tap for next week, and then I'll take some questions if you have them. Next week's going to be a very packed program, and all of them are packed, right? There's not a lot of downtime here. Jeez, what should we talk about next? Well, next week, speaking of ambitious programming, I've put a lot on the card, so to speak. What I'd like to do is revisit cantatas. Remember I told you that there are over 200 of them, and therefore it's a treasure trove, but a very daunting treasure trove to study. So we're going to look at a couple of unusual pieces next week. We're going to look at a solo cantata written for one vocalist and one vocalist only in cantata 51. Jauchzet Gott in allen Landen. Rejoice, praise God in all lands. And then we're going to look at cantata 140. which was written in 1730, and it's on the text, Bach hat aufgerufst uns die Stimme, set to a beautiful chorale melody by Philip Nicolai, written in 1540. Bach takes that tune, which was almost 200 years old, and he works it into this incredible fantasia, and the text there means something like, wake up. The voice is calling to us. Wach auf, wake up. Ruft uns die Stimme. The voice is calling to us. It's a German grammar. Ruft uns die Stimme literally means calling to us is the voice. That's, have you ever heard what Mark Twain said about German? You can have a whole sentence and then, you know, six verbs on the end of the sentence. That's German grammar. All right, so we'll start with cantatas next week. We'll get through that. We'll get through it fairly briskly, and then we'll turn our attention to something which we could spend an entire lecture series talking about, and perhaps that will be a desideratum down the line, and that's going to be Bach's Passion Oratorios. So we'll dip our toes in the water. Now, there are two of them, and they're over, one of them is over 2 hours, the other is right around 2 hours. So we'll just dip our toes in the water, and then maybe we'll leave the Passions for a later date to revisit. So that will be next week. Cantatas and the Passion Oratorios. As usual, you've been a wonderful audience. Look at this. So let me take some questions, sir.
The trumpet didn't have valves, but it was using the speakers.
Yes, there are little holes which will change the intonation. Yes, but they're you can't even see them, they're so small. Yeah. Sir.
Quick question. What's the difference between a natural words and natural
song? Natural means no valves.
Thank you.
Yep.
And second, do you have any advice for how we should understand the color graphic?
Yeah, so what I would do is this. When you listen to any score that has a color graph layout, and we'll look at one more or maybe two more in week four, see if your ear can match any one voice. That's all you have to do. Start with one voice, any one color. See if you can follow it, just one. Now, if you get there, you've already done the hard work. Now latch on to another one. Forget the first one and say, okay, I'm not going to look and see if I can hear the green line. Now I'm going to try to hear the yellow one. And it gives you a very profound appreciation for the counterpoint of those voices. So just focus on one and see if you can distill it, if you will, out of the texture. Great. Questions, lots of questions. In the back.
Did Bach hold the music of any of his contemporaries in high esteem?
Great question. Did Bach esteem the music of his contemporaries? I'll give you one example, and that's Vivaldi. He copied out Vivaldi concerti, even arranged some of them for his own use. And the other example would be Handel. Bach very much wanted to meet Handel, but Handel lived in England. Handel visited Germany a couple of times while Bach was living, of course, not too far away from where Handel visited. Both times, Handel begged off at the last minute. And scholars love to debate why was Handel at some at this point. Handel was more famous, he was wealthier. Did he feel like, gosh, I don't want to meet this guy? He's better than me, but he's living out in the sticks, and I'm hobnobbing with the King George II of England at the time. So we don't know. He might have just legitimately been saying that. Next question.
What is the relationship?
Two great questions. Let me spend a short time. The first one's on cadence, right? A cadence is a moment of arrival. Here is a cadence. Creates a satisfying sensation, an arrival point. If you liken it to punctuation, some people say that it's the period at the end of the sentence, or maybe it's an exclamation point, or maybe it's a question mark, right? It could be any number of things, but there are various types of cases, but that's the first one. Now the second point, counterpoint. Counterpoint refers to the interaction of independent voices. So they're not following a pattern of melody and harmony. Counterpoint means you have independent melodies. So that would be, you know, that idea of just constant independence in the voices. And the way you can tell if it's contrapuntal is your ear will often say, what the heck am I supposed to listen to here? Where's the tune? And you often, with Bach, don't get a traditional tune, not one that's particularly singable at any rate. Great questions. Yeah.
Am I understanding correctly that the orchestral music was secular and the vocal music was for...
That is correct. Yeah, Bach's orchestral music is overwhelmingly of a secular nature. Some instrumental music is sacred or liturgical. The organ works often are. But for the most part, the Brandenburg Concerti, the orchestral suites, those are going to be totally secular pieces written for pleasure and enjoyment and not for meditation and soul searching. So.
And while Bach was writing these cantatas and whatever, there were 50 other composers all around
doing
that, the particular cities of Germany.
Oh, yeah. Every church. Would have
a body of work that was repeated all
around? Great question. The question is about other composers doing similar things. Well, we know that there was a tremendous amount of piracy in those days. There's no intellectual property laws in the 18th century. So it wasn't uncommon. Handel, by the way, was notorious for pilfering other people's works and fashioning them into his own. How many people know the chorus from Messiah? Oh, unto us a child is born. Started as an Italian cantata. Nobody knows the name of that guy who wrote it. Savini, Carlini, Fettuccini, I don't remember. Well, that's the point. Nobody knows his name, but everybody knows Messiah and For Unto Us a Child. But Israel and Egypt, half of it is pirated. Half that music is written by other people. So yeah, that happened.
Did Bach ever write music for a musician? Did they ever do this social thing? And would he write for people on instruments he knew they could play on?
Yeah, great question. Did Bach write for people where he knew that they had the chops to pull it off? We'll see that next week when we look at Cantata 51, which has another virtuoso trumpet part. Bach was living in a totally different city and met a totally different virtuoso trumpet player, so he wrote it, and it also has that very high range and that very fast parade of 16 notes which requires dexterity. So yes, he did. He would also write organ parts for his sons to play. A good example of that is Cantata 49. Gehe und suche mit Verlangen. Go and seek with desire and yearning. And that one was written for CPE Bach, almost certainly. CPE was like 15 years old, and Bach's like, all right, you ready for this? We've got to throw him in the deep end of the pool. Let's have him play the organ obbligato part here. So yeah, he did that.
Did they play for, just to get together?
We don't know for sure exactly what happened, but we know that everyone in the Bach family was, one degree or another, musical. And so we imagine that the Bach apartments above the rectory in the Thomaskirche were filled with music all the time. They had a lot of kids.
Two more questions.
It's time after five, yeah. Great question. We often point to Felix Mendelssohn as the sort of great resurrector, if you will, of Bach's music. But that was earlier. He, in the 1820s, discovers the St. Matthew Passion. So we wouldn't be surprised. Of course, Mendelssohn's dead by 1850. He died at 38 from a series of aneurysms, strokes, we don't know exactly. So I want to say someone who was working in Leipzig. That might have been Robert Schumann. Schumann was alive in 1850, and 49, I think, is the year the Brandenburg were discovered. So I'll say what any good professor should say. I'm going to look into it, and I'll get back to you next week. If I had to guess, I would say Robert Schumann is the answer. That's your Ida
Fodder?
Sure. Probably not, no, because their paths would not have really crossed. Bach would have filled out requisitions to get whatever instruments he wanted, but more likely, he would have said to his boss, hey, I'm writing this cantata and I really want a virtuoso recorder player, can we hire one? And that recorder player is going to have his own kit with him or all of his recorders. So Bach wouldn't have any reason to interface with the maker, because he's not a recorder player. So he's going to hire people who've already got their own collection of instruments. And by the way, those recorders, depending regionally on where you were tuned differently And that creates a lot of questions of modern pieces, which you have a cantata in E major, but quarters don't play in that key. So we think that somebody had a recorder that was just made and tuned to a different key, and Bach would have had to write out a score in a different key from the rest of the instrument. It makes your head spin to think about how difficult music was back then to pull it off, to execute it. And when you think, as we'll talk about next week, of the frequency which Bach composed, it really is mind-bending. Maybe one last question.
I thought the recorders and the bassoon sound like organ pipes. And would that be something he may have thought about?
Yeah,
his
so
career
organ
is non-secular to performing in a secular
environment. Yeah. On an organ, you've got all those, remember we talked about stops that open up different pipes. Now, in addition to, of course, sound and volume and timbre, you've also got the latter issue of timbre, which is sound color, sound quality. You can have organs that sound like flutes. You can have organs that sound like bassoons, have a buzzier, reedier quality. You can have brass stops. And it just depends which knobs you push and which knobs you pull. So the intricacy of the instrument, I think, as you study it more and more, it takes on almost a mythical quality. And if you see it played by a real organ virtuoso, it can be spellbinding and breathtaking to it. Speaking of breathtaking, just wait till we get to the cantatas and passions next week. They're some of my favorite pieces to talk about, and I look forward to seeing everybody back here next Tuesday at 7 p.m.